30 seconds. Here we go.
Welcome to our Good Friday worship service from Lutheran Memorial Church in Pierre. Lutheran Memorial is located at the corner of Nicklin and Prospect, just west of the state capitol. The ministers at Lutheran Memorial are Senior Pastor Craig Wexler and Deacon Chris Wallman. Special music will be provided tonight by Gene Lumby and Pastor Craig. Our organist is Linda Steele. Our service is about to begin, and our opening hymn is Beneath the Cross of Jesus, number 338 in the ELW Red Hymnal.
To walk upon.
We gather here at the foot of the cross and hear the seven last sayings of Jesus. Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with Jesus. When they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." And the soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews."
Content to let the world go by to know.
One of the criminals who were hanging there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, "Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lima sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Which once was bright as morn, thy grief
After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." While the sun's light failed and the curtain of the temple was torn in two, Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I command my spirit. Having said this, he breathed his last.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and his Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thinking about this night and thinking about this moment, I guess I've been, in one way, shape, or form, writing this sermon for most of my life. A sermon that probably started with a question years ago that I actually remember quite vividly. I was talking to Deacon Chris a few days ago. I was talking about growing up, and the very first congregation that I was a part of as a little child was Our Savior's Lutheran in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. And I remember one of the traditions at Our Savior's, they had a reenactment. A reenactment of the passion play, so to speak, the passion moment. And there were the actors, there were the soldiers, there was Jesus, there was the cross, the women, the tomb, the angels, everything. And that was a moment in that Holy Week prior to Easter. I also remember it was a sunny day. I remember at the end of it all, they gave us kids a little wooden cross necklace. Not the traditional cross that has the vertical going above the horizontal peak, but the traditional T-style cross that the Romans used. It was just a piece of twine, a string that went around your neck, but I remember holding that cross. I remember sitting in my parents' car, and I remember asking the question, "Mom, what does it mean to be a Christian? What does it mean to be a Christian?" I remember my mom saying, "Craig, well, it means that you believe that Jesus died for your sins. It means that Jesus died for your sins, and you believe this." I was 9 years old. I think in that moment, in that time, that answer sufficed for me. And I'm guessing my parents are probably grateful that I didn't ask any more questions at that point. Amen? Amen? The few of us in here that can respond, amen? Because as a father of two beautiful, smart little girls, they're full of questions. Some of them are easy questions. And some of them are incredibly profound, incredibly deep, incredibly theological. What does it mean to be a Christian? And I think in one hand, for us, each and every day, we would like to think that the answer to that question is easy, is simple. And I think at the crux, it is the answer that we believe Jesus died on the cross for the sake of my sins. However, the longer that I've walked in my journey of faith, and even longer now that I am a pastor of nearly 10 years now, I've come to believe that many of us Christians as we call ourselves, struggle with settling with the simplicity of that answer. we struggle with the simplicity of that answer. This is that point in which those of you that are at home watching this, I invite you to strap your seatbelts on your recliners or your couch or your chair or whatever it is you're doing, because now we're going to go deep in theology. This is my favorite sermon to give of all year. This is when we understand piece by piece, connect the dots of exactly what happened that Deacon Chris just read. Exactly the point of that cross and what it means to be Christian and how those pieces come crashing home into our living rooms, come crashing home into the sanctuary, come crashing into our hearts and minds as to what he did on that cross. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. The Word was with God. God created everything through breath, through word. He created all of the land, all of the sea, the light, the darkness, the sun in the skies, the depths of the oceans, and in the animals, the beasts of the sea, the beasts of the land. And in that final moment in his creation story, he creates man. He creates humanity. He creates human beings. And each and every one of those steps, each step of the way, Jesus hasn't entered the picture yet. God says, it is good. It is good. It's not perfect. Would we long for perfection? Absolutely. Our entire lives, we are striving for perfection in one way or the other. We put on those masks each and every morning, pretending that we can obtain perfection. But each and every moment, we are reminded that God says it is good. We are good. They are good. And if God creates everything, and if we profess that we believe that, we believe in the Word of God, and we believe that the story tells us this, then we also must believe that God created the system of justice. He creates the good and the evil. He creates the good, the bad. He creates all of the heavenly realm, and he creates the justice that comes with it. Hence the tree in the garden. Hence, setting up time with the Ten Commandments. We have these moments in which God gives us direction. He gives us purpose. He gives us the guidelines. He gives us the rubric of life. And attached to that rubric of life, he also says the wages of sin, the wages of sin is death. The beginning, the end, the Alpha, the Omega, the creation and the antithesis to that creation. And time again, God upholds his promise, upholds his commandments, and the wages of sin is death. And time and again, God creates opportunities of grace, sin, judgment, grace. Our confirmation kids out there listening have heard me teach this time and time again, sin, judgment, grace, sin, judgment, grace, sin, judgment, grace. And that grace comes in peculiar opportunities, but that judgment, God has to remain just. Because God is God. God is not a liar. God is not broken. God is not sinful. God is God. And he has to answer to the brokenness of humanity. But he's getting tired of all the death. He's getting tired of the brokenness. He's getting tired of the rules and the regulations being used for all the wrong reasons. He's getting tired of the judgment. He's getting tired of the who's in and who's out. He's getting tired of the Pharisees sitting in the Moses seat inside the doorway of that synagogue, looking at those who are walking up the stairway into that synagogue and saying, "You cannot come in here. You are unclean. You are unclean because you must be a sinner. You are unclean because your ancestors must have been sinners. You cannot be a part of us. You cannot be a part of our community. You cannot experience love because that's how far we have fallen as human beings from God's grace." And God frowns, scratches his head, and weeps. He weeps over our brokenness. So I use the analogy I've always used. It's like a parent saying, "Gosh, if I can't trust you to do it, I'm just going to come down there and do it myself." God in the flesh, O come, Emmanuel. Christ comes to the earth. He comes to the earth to teach what God has given the commands for, to teach about relationship, to teach about compassion, to teach about mercy, to reestablish sin, judgment, grace, to reestablish the grace component to that, to reestablish the opportunity of love, sanctity, and community. And God knew exactly what he was getting into. In fact, it's God that knows the end of the story. God knows that the cross is to come. He even spoke to the prophets hundreds of years before that, saying that this is going to be how I am going to correct my justice system that I created. Because God is a just God. And if God is a just and honest God, only God can correct it. Amen? Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Linda. Only God can correct his system. And he needs to do that through the blameless, spotless lamb that is his son. His son grows up living a sinless life, a life of compassion, mercy, and grace, teaching, preaching, and loving. And it is only the spotless lamb that can take on all of the sins of the world. Our sins, your sins, my sins. And he goes to the cross, and those sins are nailed to that cross for our sake. Now, this is the part of the sermon that I've probably been writing since I was 9 years old that I've never done on Good Friday before. Two things that I read on a regular basis that absolutely mold and shape my theology time and time again is first and foremost C.S. Lewis's The Screwtape Letters. The Screwtape Letters is this beautiful story in which C.S. Lewis writes this interaction between Wormwood and Screwtape. Screwtape is this young demon. He's a young demon in training. He's been given his first assignment, a young British soldier who is in the throes of World War II. And Screwtape is writing letters back and forth to his uncle Wormwood, the eldest demon, the demon that has been trained, the demon that has won more lives, more souls than anyone can count. And Screwtape needs Uncle Wormwood's advice. So he's writing back and forth, and Wormwood describes to him how you do this. He says, you can't just possess. You just can't take control. You do not have that capacity. Our enemy, and those are the words that he uses, our enemy, by the way, the demons, they know exactly who is Lord. Amen? Amen. The demons know their enemy, and they know that he is powerful. You can't just come in and take the day. You have to distract. You have to coax. You have to nudge. You have to persuade. Use the tools of anger. Use the tools of dividing relationships amongst those loved ones. But each step of the way in the story, God also provides. God provides this beautiful young lady that gives this young soldier hope in his life. And even Uncle Wormwood says, use that lady, use the in-laws, use the distraction, use those opportunities to dig deep, to claw yourself in. And as the book progresses, time and time again, they're losing traction. The demons are losing traction. It's one of my favorite books because years ago when C.S. Lewis was interviewed about this book, C.S. Lewis admits that he actually was scared when he got done writing it because it was the easiest book he ever wrote. It took the shortest amount of time for him to sit down and write from the perspective of the devil. It had never been done before, he had never done it before, and it was the easiest book he ever wrote. That imagery sticks in my head. It sticks in my head for who we are as human beings. It sticks in my head with where we're at today, all the distractions of the world, the distractions of the world that we live in right now, the distractions of everything we're hearing, all the different voices we're hearing, all the different nudging, the anxiety, the frustration, the anger, the bitter feelings, and it's coming to a head. And then I remind myself of the other text that we read every single week in worship that also has molded and shaped this sermon for decades now. And that is that part of the Apostles' Creed where we hear the words, where we profess the words, when the apostles were brought in front of the Roman authorities and said, "What is it that you truly believe? Hear it now, say it now, so that we can finally get this over with." The apostles said, "He died on the cross. He descended into hell. And on the third day, he rose again." This is where we go into Pastor Craig's imagination for a little bit. So if you need to close your eyes at home, if you need to close your eyes here, Chris, Jean, Linda, Jeff, go for it. I always wanted to write a sermon about that Saturday. Saturday, Holy Saturday. He descends into hell. Jesus opens his eyes. He realizes he's moving, he's mobile. He realizes he's walking down this tunnel and there's a glow at the end of that tunnel. And he walks and the glowing gets brighter and brighter. And as he walks, it's not a bright white light, it's like a glowing ember of flames. And he comes to the end of the tunnel, and you could say maybe it's Screwtape or Wormwood standing there to meet him. And they call him by name. He's no longer known as the enemy because he's in their presence. They call him by name and they say, "Jesus, Yeshua, come inside. Someone would like to meet you." They walk down the long corridor. They walk down that hallway. It's not quite as dark anymore because of all the glowing embers around them. They walk down there and they walk into this glorious, massive kitchen. And there is the devil himself. They're looking around the table. There's some guests. There's some people there. There's some demons there. And there's an empty spot. And the devil says, "Jesus, come. I've been waiting for this day for so long. Come sit down. Sit down." Jesus does. He's not reluctant at all. He gently, graciously walks over, takes his spot, and he sits there, and a conversation breaks loose. Questions upon questions. All those questions we ever wanted to know. And a discussion about the devil and his work on earth. And Jesus looks at him and he says, "You've been busy. You've been busy. I almost commend you for how busy you are, if only you did it for different reasons." And they get into that fateful discussion years ago when the devil himself, he got so awestruck and frustrated with his role in the heavenly realm, and God and him have this deep-hearted debate, this conversation, and the devil, he doesn't want anything to do with this. He gets so frustrated because God does this one thing. He does this one beautiful, miraculous thing. He gives us the opportunity of free will. Huh. Even the angels don't have that gift. And Satan, which in Hebrew means the great opposer, begins to rise up. He and his faithful few. And St. Michael, as the story goes, as the biblical Christian story goes, they're heaved down out of the heavenly realm, cast down to the earth, and there is where Lucifer, the devil, reigns supreme. And Jesus acknowledges this. He says, "You have been a busy guy. You've been a busy guy. I don't understand it. I'm not sure why this concept of free will goes so far against what you believe. And I want you to know, devil, I've been watching, I've been seeing, I've been listening, I've been praying, I've been healing, I've been teaching. And what I see is that, my gosh, you have gotten desperate over those years. You've gotten desperate over the centuries. You're desperate because you are scared. And the lesson you are teaching is to bring fear to everyone else that listens to you. Because you are scared." It's interesting, the devil in my imaginatory story, he's not upset at this point. Because truth always wins. And he knows that what Jesus is saying is absolutely true. They get up from the table and the devil says, well, since you're here, Jesus, can I show you around? And they go on a walk, kind of see what's all going on down there. And then they get to this moment in which they get to this room and this door is open. The devil pushes the door open. He takes Jesus in and he says, Jesus, I want you to look around. This is your place. This is your place. And Jesus just kind of has a snicker on his face, a grin on his face. And he says, I'm not so sure, devil. I'm not sure what you're up to right now. And the devil pauses and he scratches his head and he says, What do you mean? What don't you understand? This is your room now. And Jesus goes, no, I think you have me confused with someone else. And he goes, no, trust me. I mean, look at the pillows over there. I even had your initials embroidered in the pillow, JC, just for you. But Jesus smiles, a big grin. He says, Satan, you really don't get it, do you? It was love that kept me on the cross, not the nails. The humans were right when they said, if you are the Messiah, just come on down off that cross. But they didn't get it because you deceived them and you taught them all the lies. You distracted them time and time again. You just don't get it. It wasn't the nails that kept me up there. It was the love that kept me on that cross so that I could fulfill the will of my Father. You just don't understand it, that today I win. It's at this moment that there's this loud rumble in my imagination, this loud rumble, and all of a sudden the hinges come bursting off the gates, the shackles break open, the chains fall to the ground, this bursting bright light comes in, it's the light of Christ, it's the light of God. Finally, Jesus looks up at Satan one more time, he goes, I win, see you later. That light, that's Sunday morning. That's Sunday morning. In which we say, He is risen. He is risen indeed. But not yet. Not tonight. Because tonight He's walking down that hallway towards that glow in which He reminds the whole world that He wins. Thanks be to God. Amen. It is at this time where we join in the hymn of the day, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. For those with hymnals at home, it is number 803, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
I sacrifice.
Let us pray, brothers and sisters, for the whole church throughout the world. Almighty and eternal God, you have shown your glory to all nations in Jesus Christ, and by your Holy Spirit, guide the church and gather it throughout the world. Help it to persevere in faith, proclaim your name, and bring good news of salvation and grace in Christ to all people. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for our sisters and brothers who share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, you give your church unity. Look with favor on all who follow Jesus, your Son. Make all the baptized one in the fullness of faith and keep us united in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray for those who do not share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, gather into your embrace all those who call out to you under different names. Bring an end to interreligious strife and make us more faithful witnesses of the love made known to us in your Son. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us pray for those who do not believe in God. Almighty and eternal God, you created humanity so that all may long to know you and find peace in you. Grant that all may recognize the signs of your love and grace in the world and in the lives of Christians, and gladly acknowledge you as the one true God. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray for God's creation. Almighty and eternal God, you are the creator of a magnificent universe. Hold all the worlds in the arms of your care and bring all things to fulfillment in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And let us pray for those in need. Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Heal the sick, comfort the dying, and give safety to travelers. Free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and deliver your world from falsehood, hunger, and disease. You are hope and light through COVID-19. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in this very trouble, that we may have the joy of receiving your help in this and all our need. We ask this through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Because a vision softly is creeping, left his
And the Lord said, "It is finished."